On January the 5th, 2015, we flew with a balloon, with a hot air balloon over the Alps. The liftoff happened close to the castle Neuschwanstein, close to Füssen, and our landing happened in the south of Verona, just 10 miles in the south of Verona. For the flight, we took 3.5 hours for 270 kilometers, and our maximum height had been 5,300 meters above sea level. This is 15,000 feet. Our course was close to south, 180 degrees most of the time, and our average speed had been 80 kilometers per hour, respectively 50 knots. We arrived at Füssen at the glider airfield at 11 a.m. and it happened to be a few degrees freezing. And here we see our VW Volkswagen bus with the balloon in the back. There had been five other teams also at the liftoff site. The weather conditions were very special. Only a few times in a year such crossings of the Alps in a hot air balloon is possible at all. You need a high and fast wind. Typically in such balloons there are 6 to 8 passengers and the pilot, but with the additional gas we need to cross the Alps, there's only space for 4. This is the speaker here on the right hand side, and as you can see there are still some clouds, but the blue sky is coming. Our weight, our starting weight is around 1800 kilograms and or 1.8 metric tons, and the maximum liftoff weight of this balloon is 2.2 tons. The volume of the hull is 7,000 cubic meters. What you need for such a liftoff is a huge area, very flat, good soil, so that you can spread out the hull of the balloons. There is oxygen because we're in very high altitudes, and the oxygen is a must for the pilot and optional for the passengers. And I tried for half an hour without oxygen, but I felt better with. Two other balloons crossed our airfield. They lifted off farther in the north, close to Augsburg, I guess. And they will, I'm afraid, fly further on than we on our way to Verona. Here we see the first balloon filled with cold air at first. Then they start the burner. And yes, they need a full bottle of gas for just filling the balloon the first time. For this reason, we carry 300 kilograms, that's more than 600 pounds of gas, propane, with us in this balloon. The time from arrival until liftoff is only 30 to 40 minutes. This is the smallest balloon, just 3 passengers and a driver, which drives the return vehicle with the space for the hot air balloon in the back to the destination site. And this typically takes longer than the flight itself. Here you see the Volkswagen bus, four-wheel drive, you need it not only here on the ice, but also on the landing sites where you have probably some farm fields, wet terrain. So having an all-wheel drive bus and the available seats for all passengers is necessary. We arrived late. We were the last of the six balloons arriving at the field, and so we will be the last lifting off. The clouds go away and the first rays of sunlight reach the top of the mountains. Wonderful colored balloons. Here you see our fan with a two-stroke engine, I think, and balloon flights are teamwork. All these, yes, there's only one pilot and the rest of the team has to do what he says. It's the captain of a ship, and there is also the return driver who knows more than the average. Well, I suggest he will be able to fly the balloon as well. The first filling of the balloon is done with cold air, just to bring the hull open. And when the hull is quite open, then you can light the fire and the burners. But you have to be very careful not to ignite the plastic of the hull. Well, hopefully the burners work better than this starter. We are below freezing, and having this strong wind from the fan is, well, not that good. So you start freezing very fast. The first crossing of the Alps in a hot air balloon happened in 1957. And crossing the Alps in a balloon as a tourist is only done since the turn of the millennium, I think. The balloon was manufactured in Germany, in the town of Trier, and has an age of about 10 years. Every year there's a full inspection of the balloon and the hull, and if something is wrong with the hull, if there's a cut in the hull in the lower part, then you're allowed to fix it yourself, but in the upper part you need a licensed company to fix it. Here you see these ice crystal clouds which will be cross later on. Here you can see the label of the company. It's Schröder, fire balloons, and it looks a little bit like Harry Potter, doesn't it? how was the broom of David, of Harry Potter named? Fire something. Here you see the top of the balloon. There is an opening and a rope with which this opening is closed, and you can tear this opening open after landing, so that the filled hull wouldn't tear the passenger's compartment over the field. Now the burner is started. Every burner of those three, each burner has a power of 2.2 megawatts. This is equivalent to 3,000 horsepowers. So we are flying over the Alp with 9,000 horsepowers. No, that's not really true. You just need one burner to cross the Alps. The others are for security purposes, and if you want to heat the air quite fast, then you take two. And in cases of emergency, when you have to rise at the top of, or in a valley, or prior to landing, you will stop the descent, then you fire with all three. The wind indicator shows a poor sign. We had a strong storm here called Elon, close at Christmas time, I think, and it was over 100 kilometers per hour, more than 50 knots at the base. So this is Delta Oscar Bay for Bavaria, and Delta Oscar are all German balloons, have the sign Delta Oscar. Our balloon is not that full as the neighboring balloon, so it will take quite a time to fill up completely. A full bottle of gas is needed to heat the first filling. And here you can see the good closed top of the balloon. We do not want to fall down during the flight. Every bottle has an indicator how full it is. This is oxygen for all passengers. Here you have in the white bottle additional oxygen for the pilot, just in case of emergency. Every bottle is really fixed, because the compartment may fall over, and then the bottles would hurt passengers. So this one is close to start. In the back there had been another balloon. This one has already started. On the right hand side, the balloon is also full, the blue one, the small one. We still heat up. The tops of the mountains are in full sunlight now. It's close to 11 o'clock a.m. No, 11:30. And here you see the man with the empty bottle, which was used to fill the balloon first, to heat up the balloon first. Now we are we lifted off also, but we are still with a safety rope. We are fixed to the car, so that we will not have an uncontrolled start. If we rise into another balloon, this might be fatal. So everybody looks at each other, that the start will have a sufficient safety distance between each balloon. A last goodbye, and the wife of the pilot drives the car to Italy over the Brenner Pass. still fixed to the ground. The small rope is for loosening the big rope. Now we are free. Lift off. Bye bye. Shortly after takeoff, we call for Munich information to hand in our flight plan, to open our handed in flight plan. We are balloons in a group. There's only one flight plan, and one of these balloons has a transponder in it, which will give a signal to the flight controllers that they are able to see our balloons. This is all natural, all plastic. So there will be no radar echo. We have to have this transponder on board, which will answer the radar signals. As we rise, our sight of the surroundings becomes bigger and bigger. This is the village of Füssen, small town, close to the castle Neuschwanstein, where King Ludwig II of Bavaria lived in summer. Here we go in close-up for Neuschwanstein, the most visited historic site in Bavaria, I think, yes. Here we see the glider strip, the airfield, and all the return vehicles are already gone. They have to hurry to catch up. This is the Forgensee, which is an artificial lake. And as we climb, our view reaches just to Lake Starnberg in the back. 3,300 meters, just 10,000 feet above sea level. And we have to rise to 16,000 feet. This is the village of Reutte in Tyrol. Yeah, there are these jets flying 30 to 35,000 feet high. We will not come close to them, but we will cross the gliding path of the international airport of Innsbruck. And so we have to be careful, and the flight control in Vienna, Austria control, has to take track of our path. This is the Plansee, and our balloons spread on an area of about a square kilometer, and the height differs, the flying height differs, or altitude differs by plus minus 100 meters. Lake Starnberg again. Blick back to the king's castle. Yes, first sunrise, sun rays on the castle, and kings wouldn't rise before noon. It was awfully dark in the morning there. This is the mountain, the Swiss mountain called Sentes, 150 kilometers away, close to the Bodensee. 4,000 meters high, 12,000 feet. And this is a view on the Zugspitze, which is the highest mountain of Germany. In the front, the village of Erwald. Meters, 15,000 feet. We reached our altitude, and in the back you can see the airport of Vienna, the black airstrip on the white field. And a wonderful view spreads over the snow-covered Alps. This is the view direction west to Switzerland. It is death silence in that altitude. Only when the burners start, you are disturbed. Otherwise, it's really, really silent. Everything is okay. The aisle is full. It is quite cold here in that height, minus 20 to minus 25. Centigrade. This is awfully cold and you need a good coverage, but there's no wind. We're driving with the wind, so there is no additional cooling by the air. This is the counter towel with the these are the is the main top of the Alps. You can see the strong winds with the snow. This is our oxygen flowing at 3 liters per minute, enough for us. The air in the balloon is 100 to 110 degrees centigrade hot. That means 200, 220 degrees Fahrenheit, and the outside is only minus 20 degrees centigrade. So the difference is 130 degrees, and we're losing constantly energy over this huge surface of the hull. So we have to heat and heat and heat again, and we will use up 200 kilograms for the crossing, and there will be 100 kilograms left for security reasons. The other two balloons which crossed our glider field are far ahead, and in front of us is the Kaunertal and the glacier, the Kauner Glacier. In the east, there are still some clouds, so it was right to drive over from Lake Starnberg to Füssen, to this glider field, to have a perfect start. Now we are over the highest summits of the Alps in this area, the view back to the Kaunertal, a famous skiing resort. And again, in the west, the centers, which is 150 kilometers away. Now we crossed the main range of the Alps and the summits will not be that high. View to the Austrian Alps. Yeah, in this balloon, a man asked his girl to marry him, and she said yes. Another reason to open a bottle this evening. This is the top of the world. Yes, in Europe, not of the whole world, the top of Europe. This year the snow coverage is not that big as the years before, so the valleys are green, and this is Italy, and it's warm from the Mediterranean, and this skiing season wasn't very successful this year. Well, on the right hand side of the balloon, there is a notch in a white notch in the mountains, a little bit off the center right. This is Passo Stelvio, Stilfsejoch, where we traveled over with our electric vehicle, a Tesla Model S. There's a video, a link here, which shows you how we crossed this pass. Top Gear voted or rated this mountain road to the best road in the world. Here you can see the streets in the lower part of the pass. And up here you can imagine where the street is, small black gravings and the houses at the top, 2,750 meters high. Here in the area is also the whisky distillery Puni. I'm afraid we didn't pass it. This is the town of Laas, where they have marble. And here you see a company cutting marble out of the mountains. In the back there is the town of Meran, and you'd find on the right hand side, yes, here, the Marmolata with the Langkofel, and now in the center, very far in the back, is the Brennerpass, Brennero, where the return vehicles will be just in this moment. A wonderful view just to the pole or even to the highest mountains of the Alps. in France. Now, it will take quite a time. And the top of the mountains are very close, even when we are 2,000 meters, 6,000 feet higher than these tops are. There is a hydrogen balloon far in the far over the Lake Garda, which is the best bath tube of Italy. And in the back, there's the Apennine, the 1,000 miles long mountain range, which goes just down to the south of Italy. There's not only the Garda, Lake Garda, but there's also the Lake Didro, which is a lot smaller than Lake Garda, but is also a very touristic region. We will see it just in a few seconds. We are 2 hours in our flight. Here are the small mountains close to Padua, and behind there is Venice on the left-hand side. Sometimes it looked like as if the balloons will fall down, but this is a kind of perspective. This balloon is still 2,000 meters, 6,000 feet above the summits of these mountains, but it loses height and we are gaining height by heating our air. And so it looked like as if this balloon falls down, but he is really safe. Lake Garda opens. And on the right-hand side, there is this Lake Idro. From the top, you can see the closed opening on the top of the hull of the balloon. Now he fires and we are losing altitude. And Lake Idro in the back. We're coming closer and the town of Riva at the north end of the Lake Garda lies ahead. in the back, Mont Blanc, the highest mountain of Europe, located in France. Again, Riva on the right-hand side, it's Montebaldo, it's called in Italy. And whoever visited Lake Garda or has seen the James Bond will remember these touristic, wonderful places. This is the small village of Malcesine. Now we passed Montebaldo and head for Verona, the hydrogen balloon in the back. This is the valley of the edge and heavy civilization. No good idea to look for a landing site here. Most is wine or stone. And you can see the area of the River Po, which is very wet, and you can see the reflexes on the water, and that's the area where we will land. And again, the French Alps with the highest mountain of Europe. Montebaldo in the front. And this is the way back we came from. Now I try a close-up of the French Alps. The quality isn't too good, but I think you're able to find the silhouette of Mont Blanc. Now we are flying over Verona, the old Roman town. There's the stadium of the soccer club, but also the old arena of the ancient Rome. ...2,000 years old. A wonderful place to listen to an opera. To an Italian Verdi opera. And very far in the back, you see something blue. That's the Adria and Venice. Again, these small mountains in the south of Padua. And now the landscape changes. There are more fields and there is pigs, pork, the Parma ham, the ham from Parma. And everywhere porks are grown up and, well, the area begins to stink. We lose our altitude and the changing wind direction brings us further to the east. You see all those fields, and every field is surrounded by a small creek where the water from the wet fields is flowing in, and then there are power lines and telecommunication lines. It's a quite a difficult area to land, so we're looking for traveling. Here is a pig farm. We're looking for traveling a little bit further to the south before we are looking for a landing field. Some of the balloons are already quite down, quite low. You can see the shadow of the balloons on the soil so that you can imagine how high they are. And they are looking for a landing site. This is the decision height. We are still higher. Our shadow is quite far away. And all those small creeks. And all those power lines, very difficult. Here the water goes through a little power station. Nothing to waste. There are the other balloons still heading south. Probably they will reach Bologna at sunset. A power line, a fresh field, no good to land, small field, a telecommunication line, a small river. Not that easy. The best place is a dry harvested field without any dung on top of it from the pigs, far away from those small creeks where the water is running in. This white balloon stopped its landing and fires a lot in the moment to cross the power line. Not that easy. It takes 10 to 20 seconds until the balloon reacts after starting the burners. Here again, looking for a landing site, but also he decides to go further to the east. Nothing serious. Too many stones on the ground. You may hurt your passengers. Now we have landed. You can see the marks on the soil where the balloon hit the bottom several times, and then we fell over because the wind was too strong. It was stronger than 5 knots, which is the maximum amount of wind where the basket will still stand. Now the hull is collected again, the marks on the ground until we fell over. We had to store the camera safely away during the landing process. It would have been good to have a GoPro mounted to the wall to see the end of the landing. A last view back into the mountains, and a wonderful day is gone, and good memories stay forever. And time for the movie maker to join the effort of recovering the hull. We landed at a small airfield with ultralight spot aircrafts, with a grass runway, you see it here, and a farmer comes up, shows up half an hour later with his machinery to carry our basket back to the airport, to this small airport where our return vehicle picked us up 2 hours later. The basket is really heavy. We lost 200 kilos, but it's still 300 kilos, 600 pounds in weight. So it's not that easy. And even with a four-wheel drive Volkswagen bus, it would have been very difficult to retrieve the basket. So with this machine, it's more easy, it's easier. Always good to have a rope. We really have to say thank you to the farmer. They offered us coffee and a warm shelter for 2 hours until the return vehicle arrived. Here he drove a second time to the landing site and recovered the hull, which is packed into this sack. Again, 300 kilos heavy, 600 pounds. And the wind still strong. Here you see the small aircraft, and there was the wish to fly back home quite fast and not to take the car with 4 hours time. The last sunbath and a wonderful day is over.